Okay, welcome everyone. Good to see the Leela here and my friend Janice is beside me. And today we're going to be looking at music in the blood, music in our DNA, so to speak, which isn't really in the blood because I think blood doesn't have DNA, but it sounds good to say music in the blood.
I had no idea it didn't have DNA.
Yeah, I think they don't have nuclei. That's the thing with blood cells. The red blood cells don't have nuclei. They just function is to carry the oxygen.
Oh.
Yeah. Wow. So. Yeah. Okay. I'm gonna share my screen. And can you see it, Dalila?
Yeah, I can see.
All right. So here we are, Music in the Blood. Today's Saturday, 28 May. And we want to answer the question, is music in our DNA? Okay, well, I did a lot of research. And this particular article is a very scholarly article. You see the names of the people who wrote this article there. It's called The Genetic Basis of Music Ability. And I'm quoting here from them. Researchers generally agree that both genetic and environmental factors contribute to the broader realization of music ability, with a degree of music aptitude varying not only from individual to individual, but across various components of music ability within the same individual. So they did a very serious study. And they believe that they found certain genes that are associated with certain kinds of music ability.
Oh,
so they were quite specific, things like memorizing lyrics, learning melodies, and we'll talk about perfect pitch in a minute. So there are various things, and they looked at different people, they looked at other studies that were done with twins and with families. And they found that really it varies. It's not like one single gene that is a gene that if you have it, you're likely to be inclined to be musical. But they're both environmental and genetic factors. So here is some details that they shared concerning the DNA. And I'll just read what this says. Some promising and converging findings have emerged with several loci on chromosome number 4 implicated in singing and music perception, and certain loci on chromosome 8q implicated in absolute pitch and music perception. Then there's a gene called the AVPR1A on chromosome 12q that has also been implicated in music perception, music memory, and music listening. And then there's another one called SLC6A4 on chromosome 17Q that has been associated with music, memory, and choir participation. So it was a really good study. If you're interested, the link is in the previous slide, and I'll share this with you so that you can have a look at what they said. All right, so let's look at absolute pitch. Absolute pitch, you probably heard of it as perfect pitch. There's some people who just seem to be born with, they can sing a C or hear a C note on the piano and know that it's a C or a D or an E or whatever it is.
They know they which just one know. It is they or just they know. Can just sing it.
They can sing it, and if their music, if then they've been taught what the notes correspond to, they can tell you what it is.
Yeah.
But they can naturally sing it, or if they know the piano, they can play it. Mm-hmm. Or if they know an instrument, they can play it on that instrument. So many researchers study the genetics of musical ability through the lens of absolute pitch, also known as perfect pitch. Absolute pitch is ability to instantaneously identify or recreate a given musical note without the benefit of a reference tone. While rare, this is a quantifiable and complex trait. And they say, this is an important thing, the absolute pitch is thought to be both environmentally and genetically influenced. So we'll look in a minute or two on that, what it is to be both environmentally and genetically influenced. And this, the source of this quote is an article called The Complex Genetics of Musical Talent by Sarah Cassidy, PhD. Okay, so these are people who have been researching and they know about this stuff. Now, I found this very interesting. This is from the same article. And Sarah Cassidy quotes, I'm quoting her here, archaeological evidence of musical instruments from 40,000 years ago indicates that humans have valued the ability to generate music for at least that long and probably longer. So, music is not something new, as we probably know in our hearts. It's been around for a long time, probably before language was generated, even certainly before the English language, 40,000 years ago. Moreover, she says, musical ability is likely under positive selection in the human population. What that means, if you think about it, is that people who make music and make music well may be more likely to survive. Right? Life is hard. People, let us say you have a person in a tribe who is very good at making music. That person is going to be valued by the tribe. They're probably going to be protected. They're probably not going to be given a job where they have to go out and hunt and get killed by the tigers and the lions and the elephants. They're probably going to have a life where they can spend their time, doing what they can do best, which is to make music, and people will enjoy it. And yeah, so that's how I see it. I think that's what it means by positive selection, that they're positively selected, and then people are attracted to people who are musical. I feel that way. I want to be with someone who is going to be giving me that lovely music, so I would be attracted to that, and then they make babies, and then so the babies pass on that gene. So she says, does that mean musicians are therefore born instead of made? She goes on to say, musical ability tends to run in families. This could suggest that musicality is inherited, but it could also suggest that early exposure to music, as would happen in a musical family, drives increased aptitude. So the environment also is important, because if you even have that gene, but you are not exposed to music, if you're taken from your family and you are brought up with people who do not have that ability, you don't hear music in the household. Your talent may not be realized because you don't have the influence of the environment to bolster and boost that. Okay. So, this is looking at practice. And some people would say, well, if you practice hard enough, you can be just as good as someone with talent. Talent doesn't really matter. Because all you need to do is practice. If you really want to do this, you practice and you'll get better and better. So, a 1993 study helped popularize the idea that we can all practice our way to tuba greatness if we so choose. The authors found that by age 20, elite musicians had practiced for an average of 10,000 hours, concluding that differences in skill are not due to innate talent. The author Malcolm Gladwell, who I admire right away, lent this idea some weight in his 2008 book, Outliers. And Gladwell cites that 10,000-hour rule in the book as a major key to success in various pursuits, not just music, which, and he mentioned the Beatles in the book, but also think other things, anything that you can practice to get better at. And so he says Bill Gates is a person who spent that many hours practicing to make better and better computers. So it's not like he had an innate ability as a computer genius. He made a lot of mistakes, and he learned and he learned and he tried and he tried, and his first computer wasn't good, And then he made more and more and more and more and more and more and more. And eventually he became Bill Gates. So anyway, so the source of this quote is from a 2014 article in Scientific American called What Do Great Musicians Have in Common? DNA. All right. So maybe, maybe not. So practice maybe is gonna help, but new research led by Michigan State University psychology professor David Hambrick suggests that unfortunately for many of us, success isn't exclusively a product of determination. Despite even the most hermetic practice routine, our genes might still leave greatness out of reach. I'm trying to move this little thing here. Okay, there's Dalila in the corner. So hermetic practice routine, I found that interesting thing. Hermetic implies you're practicing all the time. You're like a hermit. That's the only thing you're doing. The only thing you're doing is practice.
Even most.
So I started to think about those countries like China and other countries where they seek out kids with talent. And then they make those kids practice. Sometimes they even have like boot camps where you have the kids in a communal, almost a familial style of living. They're together, they're practicing all the time, but they also have talent. They choose the ones who have talent, they groom them. And that's why you can get countries where you have these teams like football or basketball, volleyball. Skating is an example of gymnastics is a typical example where you have people who have talent, then they're sought out, they're groomed, and they practice until they make that you know medal winning ability grow in those children. I think it's kind of strange, you know, and it causes a lot of problems because if you don't love to do something, even if you have the talent, you might not love to do it. That not might not be your personal thing that you want to do with your life.
It makes it sad.
It's sad. It's sad if someone, you know, is that happens to them and they that's what they have to do, you know, and they don't really love it. But anyway, so my thought was that singing on choirs, that's another way to imbibe talent and to brew talent. Many successful solo singers, we know whether they have families who were musical or not, they grew their talent at choir practice. I can think of many singers who started out, you know, in church, in choirs, and a lot of African-American men and women especially, I think, but possibly men too, you know, they started out singing in choirs. And there are some choir people who sang in choirs in our list. We have a video YouTube playlist, and we'll look at that in a minute. But here are some conclusions. So I would say that this sentence here on top on the right, it encapsulates what I think about the whole topic of nature versus nurture when it comes to music. I think it's a myth that a lot of practice will bring greatness. I think if you don't have any natural ability, I don't think a lot of practice is going to necessarily make you great. I think also if you love something, though, I don't see how you could love it and not already have that gene in there that is sort of, I think it's the genes that make us love a certain thing more than another thing. Because we have that in us for the perception I'm thinking about now in terms of music. Because like when I hear certain songs and certain notes, it does something to me. I feel almost like a physical sensation in the top of my head when I hear certain notes. Seriously. So I feel like it's something that if you love it, that means that you have something in there. Whether you start out with it looks like a natural talent, whether your voice has that raw good sound that some people just seem to have, that you can develop it more because you have something in there, you have a kind of musicality. So here's a conclusion. Here, David Hamrick is quoted in What Do Great Musicians Have in Common? And he says, I think it's important to let kids try a lot of different things and find out what they're good at, which is probably also what they'll enjoy, which is what I was trying to say, but he said it better. What you're good at is probably what you'll enjoy. But the idea that anyone can become an expert at anything isn't scientifically defensible, and pretending otherwise is harmful to society and to individuals. So that's my conclusion. And I wanted to play this, but guess what? I'm gonna have to stop sharing because I'm not sharing sound right now. So I like this video. It's not the best vocal from Andy Grammer, but I just love that he went into this school and without any fancy equipment, reverb, anything like that on his voice, he played guitar and sang the song, and the kids were singing along and dancing, and it's just a beautiful sight.
One, two, three. Y'all been grinding so long, been trying to see it for years. And I got nothing to show, just coming this rope, I ain't riding. And if there's a man upstairs, he keep bringing me rain. Sending up prayer, something changed. I think I finally found my hallelujah. I've been waiting for this moment all my life. Now all my dreams are coming true. Yeah, I've been waiting for this moment. And it's good to be alive right about now. Woo!
I think I'm gonna stop the recording now, and we're gonna just vibe and chat about the songs on the playlist.